working group, took the G20 as an opportunity to spark some of the sorts of conversations and include the sorts of voices that the official G20 we felt simply wouldn't be including or recognising. So while the G20 closed off the inner city to everyone except delegates and security personnel, the People's Summit opened up 9 venues across West End and South Brisbane to open participation and attendance by anyone who wished to be there. We brought together a total of around 58 film screenings, workshops, discussions, panel sessions, and gigs. And while the G20 had a total budget of $370 million, the People's Summit operated with a total budget of just a few grand, which was entirely collected from donations by community members. I think the summit itself has been an incredible showcase of what's possible with just some hard work and a lot of community support. It's been one of our aims right from the outset to build a diverse, resilient and creative community alliance, and we hope that the momentum that's been generated in response to the Brisbane G20 might extend well into the future. Winnle Byanyima more fully. She's a grassroots activist, human rights advocate, senior international public servant and world-recognised expert on women's rights, and the executive director of Oxfam International. She was born in Uganda in 1959 and earned engineering degrees in the United Kingdom. She was appointed to the diplomatic service in 1989, where she represented Uganda in France and at UNESCO in Paris. She returned to Uganda in 1994 and for the next 10 years served as a Member of Parliament, created an all-woman parliamentary caucus and was founding leader of the Forum for Women in Democracy. Please join with me in welcoming Winnle Byanyima.
Inequality was then and is still now difficult for me to accept. It is unjust. It's just not fair. It's immoral. Inequality is choice, it's political choices. You make different choices, you reduce it. We know what can be done. If you tax progressively, if you stop tax dodging and tax evasion, if you put the resources you get from taxes into public services, health and education especially, if you close the wage gap between men and women, these are the things that will bring you reduced inequality and faster growth. Climate change is an issue of justice too. The poorest countries who've contributed almost nothing to this problem are the ones facing the impacts today. They need resources for adaptation and to move their economies on a low carbon path. Because these two challenges, inequality and climate change, show us that the solutions don't lie just at the global level, like these leaders are, or the national level, but that solutions lie at the community level.
I'd next like to welcome up Sharan Burrow. Sharan, by way of brief introduction, is the General Secretary of the International Trade Union Confederation and a former president of the Australian Council of Trade Unions from 2000 and 2010. She's the first woman to become General Secretary of the ITUC since its foundation in 2006. And was only the second woman to become president of the ACTU. Join me in welcoming Sharan Burrow.
Even in the G20 countries, there's over 100 million people unemployed. And that doesn't tell you the whole story, because in the global workforce, there are 40% of people who have no status as workers. They work, but they work in the informal sector. We were trying to raise these figures at a press conference Winnie and I just did. In fact, we can share with you that they cancelled our press conference. So we just went and held our own press conference in the middle of the press centre, and guess what? The press came. And so So that kind of energised us a bit, nothing like a little bit of civil disobedience to, you know, kind of get your spirit going. And then there's energy without climate. You can talk about energy here, but you can't talk about climate. It just doesn't make any sense. We've got to decarbonise our societies by 2050. Australia's going backwards, so this government's not serious. I don't think they're serious about people. I'm not going to get into the domestic front. But I know if there are community groups with this kind of commitment and energy right across Australia, you'll win. You'll take back our country, but you'll help us win globally for the kind of inclusive societies that we want. We're not here to drive the basis of corporations. We're here to drive a basis for communities.
Our next speaker is Lez Malezer, who is the co-chair of the National Congress of Australia's First Peoples. He's a full-time delegate to the United Nations on Indigenous issues. He held responsibility as chairperson of the Global Indigenous Peoples Caucus when the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples was adopted in 2007. Mr. Malezer was a negotiator for the Indigenous Peoples in finalisation for the Nagoya Protocol under the Convention on Biological Diversity in 2010. Please welcome to the stage.
Essentially, the global order we see today is built upon the United Nations and the intergovernmental system that has developed since World War II. And the concept at the end of World War II was enough is enough, no more world wars. People have to have rights. So the Charter of the United Nations is based upon the words, "We the peoples of the world." And in that sense, we must keep reminding ourselves that the governments and the institutions that speak are simply the representative of the peoples. Unfortunately, as we know, the governments don't necessarily do a good job. Well, are we benefiting? No, we're not. The Northern Territory Land Rights Act, which was adopted 40 years ago in 1976, gave the equivalent of all mining royalties back to the Aboriginal population in the Northern Territory. However, the Aboriginal benefits account is now being administered by the minister, and the concern is that it's being administered to deliver funding that government should be delivering itself through government programs. So the community has already lost control of that. The Native Title Act, since it was amended in 1998, divorces us from that ownership. Now the legislation only recognises the right if people can prove to a court that the association they have today is the same association they had 200 years ago. And of course, I don't think anybody in the world can prove that they have the same association with their territories they had 200 years ago.
I'd next like to welcome to the podium Benedict Coyne. Benedict is a human rights lawyer and a slam poet in his spare time. He's also the state convener and a national committee member of the Australian Lawyers for Human Rights. And he was recently awarded the 2014 Australian Lawyers Alliance and Amnesty Emerging Lawyer of the Year Award. Please welcome Benedict.
To reflect on the concept of erecting fences to keep others out, and it's certainly been part of our history, and it's certainly part of our present. Everything that Sharan and Winnie were talking about tonight, and I guess what this Briscan summit has been about, is about the co-opting of the public commons into private pockets. And being one of the 26 founding parties of the Refugee Convention, coming out of the Holocaust, coming out of World War II and saying never again. And isn't it scary to see how short our memories are and how strong and potent amnesia is? And whilst Australia is dealing with literally a drop in the ocean, literally 2.2%, our government is doing its darndest in Orwellian doublespeak to try and convince the electorate that the latest caseload legacy migration bill is in fact about codifying our international obligations. I must say my concern is that all of this is being done in our name and we haven't stopped it. To see beyond boundaries and borders, differences and disorders, distances and distorters, instances of new world orb defrauders. The moon is mesmerising tonight, her tune energising our flight, yet we're toiling with this lucky country's spoils. Where organic seeds thrust in dead insecticide soil, it burns our hands, we're clambering, our lumbering limbs slandering this oil, slicking this shiny new machine. built up on a billion burnt-out bodies of hollowed-out computer screens. They reflect in the eyes of our children, no longer asking why, their wonder thieved by a sly cyber spider weave webbing the sky. So I'm climbing, rhyming up this poetry, dancing along tangent branches that avalanche in symphonies of seeds, planting uncut keys of chameleonomy deep in the dark soils of soliloquy. In brain bubbles to our stubble mouth, we huddle down, duck, cover and dance soft in the hard Fukushima rain. Suck the juice out of life, don't chew on the pain. Own the moment, dethrone the cloning, stuff the capital coma, too much money is boring.
I'd next like to welcome to the podium our final speaker for this evening, who is Michelle Maloney. Michelle Maloney holds a Bachelor of Arts and Laws with Honours from the Australian National University and has more than 20 years' experience designing and managing climate change, sustainability and environmental justice projects in Australia, the United Kingdom and the USA. She's the national convener of the Australian Earth Laws Alliance, the chairperson of the Environmental Defenders Office Queensland, and the Australian representative on the Executive Committee of the Global Alliance for the Rights of Nature. Michelle Maloney.
The injustices between us as a species are horrific, but the injustices that we weld upon the rest of the Earth community is even worse. Historically, our culture, industrial Western society, has seen the natural world as nothing more than a bunch of objects that we can carve up. We have commodified everything. Climate change is becoming the ultimate test of our capacity to rein ourselves in. I almost laugh when I hear about the idea of environmental management. We are not managing the Earth. We're meant to be managing ourselves, and we're failing dismally. We're often so busy scrambling down on the distributive stuff, how do we all get enough? We're actually forgetting how much should we have. We've heard a lot tonight about the importance of jobs, and absolutely I support that. My husband's out of work right now and it's a killer. It's totally shit being broken in industrial society. But the ultimate thing is our structures have to change. We cannot have a pro-growth economic system. We know that. So what are we doing about it? When people say to me, well, how could you have rights for a tree? I say, well, how can you have rights for an entity as fictional as a unicorn? It's called a corporation. We've made them as strong as they are. We need to break them down. And we need to create, in a future governance system, a deep, deep respect for the incredible interconnected Earth that sustains us and has a right to exist. So that's about all I wanted to say. I think the solutions are out there. A lot of it is breaking down power. Australians are basically a fairly polite society. There's a whole bunch of awesome people who are deeply radical, and they get up every damn day and they fight for what is right. But the mainstream community is still fighting for itself and it's still basically polite. And I love what Drew Hutton said when they started the Lock the Gate movement. They had to remind farmers that it was okay to be a little bit rude now and then, to actually lock things up, and that's good. It makes for a lovely society. But I think it's time for all of us who know deep down exactly what needs to be done to just keep on going, to question the power structures, and also just to find all those optimistic spaces that keep us happy, that keep us going, and redefine the world the way we know it already is. Let's not continue to mourn what's been lost. Let's really fight hard and embrace and celebrate what we have, because there's still an awful lot of good out there. That's all. Thank you.
We stand for inclusivity and we stand for peace. Our priorities are really just seven. First of all, Briscan from the beginning and the People's Summit is concerned with solidarity with First Nations people and with Aboriginal people, the Aboriginal Sovereign Embassy, who have their events in Musgrave Park at the moment. So our first priority is sovereignty for First Nations peoples. Equality and justice for all. Commitment to fight for ecological protection and to confront climate change. Participation in true democracy and decision making. Ensuring food security. Opposition to the dominance of the market over society. Collaboration over competition. Each of these priorities has obstacles to overcome, and we're committed to decisive action to confront them. It's scribbled out on our poster. We call out for a revisioning of economic growth, and this means the development of alternatives to the economic system, the current economic system. This week has been an opportunity to learn, for us to strategize together, to practice solidarity, and to build links between different social movements. To reinforce a commitment to decisive action means maintaining these links into the coming weeks and months and years. And we'll all march tomorrow, but that's just the beginning. We'll continue to meet to make sure that the networks we have made this week will be a platform for future action. And I'd like to hand this over to Kıvanç İlyasik from Turkey, who's the Director of International Relations at DİSK, the Confederation of the Progressive Trade Unions of Turkey.
So, sisters and brothers, I'm here from Istanbul after a long way. I'm here in Brisbane to participate in People's Summit. So I bring greetings from Gezi Park to you, those young activists who occupy streets of Turkey. And I bring greetings from the fighters of Rojava in Kobane, who are fighting against ISIS to defend their lands, not only to defend their lands, but they are fighting against ISIS to defend freedoms and to defend people's democracy. So you are welcome to Alter G20 People's Summit to discuss about social justice, ecology, to discuss about the rights of oppressed people, and to discuss about issues around gender equality. So see you in Istanbul, sisters and brothers.